A clunky pod for a clunky game. It's me, Ren Dax, and I talk Buccaneers 49ers, and then I take your questions from the chat room on this edition of the Instacast. Welcome to the Pewtercast Instacast. Brent is so much better at opening than I am. I am Rendex. I'm going solo tonight because Brent is on the road from Jacksonville. I'm sure he's watching. I'm going to say, Brent, please don't get in the chat room and make some comments. Just get home safe and everything will be fine there. A disappointer one. I mean, you know, this is what we get for, I don't know, how long have we waited, like 9 months? And, you know, this is the effort that we get. And it was kind of the same old Bucs in a way. You know, I felt like the Bucs dominated, San Francisco, especially on defense, shot themselves in the foot, you know, on offense. I mean, how much, I knew Brent would say hi. Brent, please drive. Don't get yourself killed. That drive where we scored two touchdowns and Dodd had two penalties, and then, Howard fumbles the ball. Like that was a total flashback to like the Redskins game. It's like, okay, like we can move the ball at will, and then we're just gonna cough it up. But yeah, this was a rough one to swallow. I'm gonna go ahead and start out with the who to blame. Number one, I don't think it's gonna be surprising to anybody, Jameis Winston. I have said on this pod and other pods when I was guest hosting that, you know, if the Bucs don't have a winning season, you know, 8-8 or better, or a disappointing season, whatever that may be for you as a fan, that it wouldn't be Jameis Winston's fault. But so far, he's proven me wrong. I don't care about the excuses, you know. You don't throw the hitch route to Barber against Sherman. Look, Sherman isn't the cornerback he used to be. He had no interceptions last year. He got like two really bad penalties. And, you know, the only time he really made a difference was when Jameis just threw him the ball and he almost dropped it. So I'm not sort of high on this Richard Sherman thing. It was a really bad pass by Jameis. And then the other one, where he was trying to throw it, you know, to Ogunbowale. And that's what really hurt, because it was all set up for Jameis to sort of wipe away all the naysayers. And this is going to be Bruce Arians' Jameis. You know, this is the new Jameis, the new Buccaneers, the new offense. Dirk Cutter's gone. And, you know, we had to go down, score a touchdown, kick the extra point to win the game, had over 2 minutes left. And on the very first play, he throws it, like he just throws it right to the corner. I know he was trying to dump it, but this is year five in the NFL. You know, Bruce Arians came out in the press conference, said, well, he needs to throw it in the dirt, but maybe if he threw it high, he didn't want to get an intentional grounding penalty. And I think he was in the end zone. It was pretty close to the end zone. So it might have been a safety. I don't know what he was thinking, but this is year five. Like, this is stuff to learn, you know, when you're starting quarterback in high school. Like, you know, it's 2 years at Florida State. I don't know how many years he started in high school, and now this is his fifth year in the NFL. Like, you just can't make that throw. Like, you can't do it. I understand what you were trying to do, but you didn't, and you just can't make that throw. That's why people don't trust Jameis Winston, because of that throw. It was perfectly set up. Like, just drive down the field. You got plenty of time, you know. You can spike the ball, and you got all your weapons there, and you know, Quan Alexander's out of the game, and you could have just dumped it off to, you know, whoever, I guess, Ogunbowale is now, looks like he's officially the third down back. You could just, like we did with Chris Rogers, just throw it to him, get 7 yards, just do that all the way down the field till you get in the red zone. But that was really disappointing. The one to O.J. Howard, you know, obviously not his fault. But, you know, that was like back-to-back turnovers almost from play to play from O.J. Howard. Because that was weird. It was like O.J. fumbled, And the Niners get the ball, and they didn't score a touchdown, but like they drove down and then moved back and then drove down and then moved back. And eventually we held them to a field goal, and now there's like hardly any time left in the second half. But, you know, we got time to drive down the field, you know, get in field goal range. You know, if for big play breaks, we get a touchdown, that'd be great. But, you know, one play, boom, it goes off Howard's hands and they intercept it. So that was like two offensive plays in a row where O.J. Howard turned the ball over, basically. And he's my second to blame guy. He led the team in targets, led the team in catches. And, you know, he's known as for this game to be, you know, sort of the GOAT. We've been waiting on O.J. Howard. You know, he did have like a nice catch on third down where Jameis rolled out and found him. But I mean, it's another disappointment for O.J. Howard. You know, those are two guys you can blame the game on if you want to, you know, pick one person to put the loss on. Also, the third guy might be a little surprising. It's half of DeGraves, and it's not VH3. It was Carlton Davis. It's a little bit of pass for Carlton because these refs, who I would love to be able to put the blame the game on, but they screwed the 49ers just as bad as they screwed us. These guys were calling ticky-tack fouls, and I'm almost positive they got a call at halftime from the NFL because they were not calling the game in the second half like they were in the first half. But Carlson got a couple of costly penalties, especially one that ended up in the Niners' lone offensive touchdown. It was third and long, and they threw it deep. And again, like I'm saying, I don't think that was a penalty by Carlton. The guy sort of ran into him. Carlton put his hands up. Didn't really impede him so much. The guy ate up the space and then cut right off him. You know, you got to – what are you going to do, let him run into you? But, you know, by the definition, it is. And, you know, if that officiating crew ever works a Ravens game, the Ravens are going to have, like, 35 defensive pass interference penalties because those guys are physical in your face. And that's the way that Hargraves and especially Carlton Davis plays. And that's what's made him sticky. But he got some, you know, like, quote-unquote bad penalties. I'm not necessarily blaming him for those. But... you know, at the end of the day, they, you know, that was the drive that extended to get, you know, the only touchdown. And the last person you want to blame it on is Bruce Arians. I mean, you should have went for the field goal. If you're there to put your players in the best position to win, possibly not making your quarterback score a touchdown late in the game to win instead of letting this drive down and get a field goal, which basically now is just over, you just got to get across, you know, midfield nowadays. I'm sorry, I got sort of a frog in my throat. I haven't really talked all day. Just to get across midfield for Matt Gay to make it, but going for it, and I understand if they would have scored a touchdown, I'd probably feel a lot different. But, you know, take the Pittsburgh game into effect. Take where he almost threw the flag. Excuse me. Let me try that again. Sorry, everybody. Dying over here. Where, excuse me, Vernon Hargraves was going to get, you know, well, he did get the DPI call, and, you know, it wasn't his fault, but he was going to throw the flag and the team, you know, held him back. Based from what I hear, he was like this, and, you know, coaches on the sideline were grabbing his arm and not letting him throw it. And then going for it, you know, like going for it on fourth down after the field goal team was already out there. And, you know, I sort of understand this logic. Well, the defense was playing well and they held him down, and they did, but the offense wasn't playing well. So, getting three would have been infinitely easier, you know, for the offense late in the game. Sorry. this is terrible. I got a frog in my throat. Let's try this again. mm. I'm gonna have a lot of editing to do. So if you're gonna put your team in the best position to win, then kicking the field goal and making it and only keeping it at three with like 4 minutes left in the game was the way to go. All right, hang on, everybody. I'm sorry. Talk amongst yourselves. I know you have been. I'm going to have to really, where am I at as far as time-wise, 14, 13? I'm going to have to go get some water because this coffee and Mountain Dew is not helping my froggy throat. I will be back in like 20 seconds. All right. Okay. Apologies, everyone. All right. This water is actually helping a lot more. I had a frog in my throat. I sound terrible. Okay, so as the head coach and as BA said, you know, you got to put your players in the best position to win. I just thought that was sort of the wrong call, especially the way the defense was handling the 49ers and how the offense was struggling. And a lot of it had to do with penalties, and a lot of it had to do with, you know, sort of clunky play calling. It was really frustrating as a fan to watch that first half because the Bucs just kept sort of shooting themselves in the foot with penalties or negative plays, or Jameis wasn't really sharp to sort of start off the game. This is getting ridiculous. So sort of to start off the game, and it was just a rough start. It was nothing, you know, we've seen that before a lot of times with Jameis Winston. So just a frustrating loss, especially the way the defense have played. I would have liked to see the defense get more pressure. They only recorded one sack. But I thought the way they played against the run was outstanding. Villavea, you know, he's going to be something special. He had a really good game. I know only if you look at the box, he only had three tackles, but you know, I think two of those were like 10 yards down the field as he's chasing down screen plays and stuff. He was consistently pushing the pockets, consistently getting quote unquote pressure on the quarterback. You know, and he looked good. Sue got a tackle for loss on a third and three. Will Golston, you know, what happened to this guy? All of a sudden, I know he only got like two or three tackles, but when they ran at him, he's really shown up as a early, at least as a run stuffing DT that we remember him like 2-3 years ago when we went 9-7. He was a big part of the reason why the Bucs defense sort of had that 5-game win streak stretch that they did. You know, so to finish off and kind of go to the dip, well, let's go to the good. Let's go to the good. Ronald Jones. I'm sure we're all happy with Ronald Jones. He averaged, I think, 5.8 yards a carry. He really didn't get rolling to the second half. I'm hoping like the clunky play calling on offense is sort of, you know, more of getting the feel of what these guys can do in game. It felt like, and like, you know, this Instacast, so it's a real raw reaction. It felt like it was run the ball 4 or 5 times in a row, pass the ball 4 or 5 times in a row, run the ball 4 or 5, especially in the second half. And I always felt like they went to the well just one too many times on the run. But also, you know, Ronald Jones kept getting yards, so that was a tough one. But I really didn't like the play calling in the red zone, you know. And to jump back to Jameis with the play calling, we saw in the Cleveland game how indecisive he was, you know, with his passes, you know, pumping, clutching, moving around in the pocket. Same thing today. And he's late with some passes, especially on those out routes. Remember the one he had in Cleveland with Scotty Miller, where it should have been a pick. There was a few today where it's like, okay, I'm predicting if they don't do something, if the route, you know, if the receiver wants to make a step to the inside to freeze the cornerback, at least get him on his heels or get him flat footed before they make the out cut. Then like 4 of these passes are going to go to the house this year because the ball is just a hair too late, or the receiver's not getting quite enough separation. You know, we've seen it sort of, we're throwing out the Dallas game. So 2 games in a row here that these cornerbacks have really got the jump on Jameis's outside routes, or you just got to take it out of the repertoire altogether. I didn't feel like there was a lot of crosses called. you know, and when we did, they were successful, like the one to Godwin, the one to Howard, things like that. I felt like there was a lot of stick routes. You go to the sticks and turn around, or, you know, just try to push the cornerback off and turn around. And there wasn't a lot of separation in there. And Jameis had to throw it in some really tight windows, especially early on. So it was just, like I said, it was just really clunky. It didn't feel good. Barber looked slow. You know, he didn't look like the Peyton Barber that we're used to. He did okay. I mean, he averaged 4.1 yards a carry. I mean, you're not getting mad at that. But I just felt like he was sort of picking and weaving his way through instead of just putting his head down, putting his foot in the ground and exploding. And that's kind of what he does best. And the last sort of thing on the offensive play calling, it's like there just wasn't enough passes to the playmakers. Like I said, OJ Howard, you know, led the teams in targets and receiving, but, you know, Mike Evans had 2 catches and Chris Godwin had 3. Like Peyton Barber had 2 catches. You know, Mike Evans had 2 catches. Like that just can't happen. Now, I haven't seen the all 22, so I don't know what they were doing on the back end of San Francisco as far as maybe they're taking away these deep stick routes, these deep crosses, these deep outs. But it was either they drilled it into Jameis's head so much that he had to get the ball out early, or that, you know, they have to figure something out to get those guys the ball more, because 5 catches total between Godwin and Evans. I mean, Godwin was supposed to have a field day, you know. It's like where's Sherman? Don't throw to him. Who else is there? You know, it's going to be Howard, or it's going to be Godwin or Perryman. Like, there's going to be 3 guys that, you know, San Francisco's secondary was terrible last year, and they didn't upgrade it at all. So we really should have been able to take advantage of them. I thought the offensive line played okay. Run blocking was much better than it was, you know, since we remember it. The pass blocking was you know, some guys got beat. You know, Donovan Smith looked foolish a couple times. You know, I thought the first penalty on Dotson for the Cam Brate first touchdown, I thought that was kind of a phantom penalty. And to be honest, I really didn't see the hold on the second one. But I was sort of writing something down at the time, and I heard Rondae Barber up on the screen said, yep, that's textbook holding. So maybe he did. It was just all in all, we had the talent. We should have won the game. We were better than they were. The defense played great. It's just we could not get into an offensive rhythm whatsoever, either by penalties, turnovers, and I'm not counting the last one because that was the end of the game. You know, penalties, turnovers, or yeah, just penalties and turnovers. Like, the refs would not get out of the way for either team in that first half. I mean, 4 touchdowns called back on penalties. That's unheard of. It's absolutely unheard of. And that was just in one half of football. I think it was in the second quarter alone. Like, you know, forget one half of football. That was all done in the second quarter. Or maybe it was the first quarter. I don't know. But, you know, those are some notes on that. It was just, it was a disappointing game. I get it. I think there's a lot to like as far as, you know, especially the defense. I thought the defensive line played well. Like I said, we shut down the run. You know, I didn't think they had a lot of guys open. And Shanahan tried really, really hard to scheme the pass rush away, which was he would do things like play fakes play action where the quarterback would roll out naked all by himself and then sometimes even throw back to the back. Or they would do bunch formations and, you know, sort of just get Kittle lost so he could just get like 7 yards. I mean, you know, it was they were going to dink and dunk to protect Garoppolo, you know, from the pass rush. And they stuck to the run just enough. But, you know, the game was lost. At the end of the day, the game was lost because of Jameis Winston, because 2 bad throws, 1 bad throw, 1 horrible decision. And, you know, that was the game. So it just felt, once again, I keep using the word clunky, it just felt really clunky. Quan Alexander ejected. Who really cares? You know, just have to throw that in there. I talked about how indecisive Jameis was and how he's late on his out routes. So yeah, I think that's really about it. You know, this show is meant for you guys, so I'm gonna go ahead and mark where I am. This might be a real short one. Sorry, everybody. 2509. And I'm gonna answer some questions. So if you have any questions in the chat room, go ahead and put them in now. And if you have anything to say, you know, I know everyone's been talking back and forth to each other, but I'll go ahead and sort of answer some questions for you here. Who'd you like? What didn't you like? Anything I said? Devin White, I'm glad you brought that up. No splash plays. He played fine. You know, the bright, you know, if you're a Devin White fan, the bright side is he captained a defense as a rookie in his first game that only gave up one touchdown. I mean, you really can't ask for more than that. And he was third in the team in tackles. I know you didn't sort of see like a tackle for loss, or you didn't see, you know, sort of these singular plays. And I know that. Thanks, Brent. Brent put in questions and comments down in the chat. You know, and White got stiff armed, and then there were the penalty stacked on top of that when, you know, the Bucs really needed to stop late in the game. And the Niners ended up getting a field goal to go up by six. Yeah, to go up by six. And everyone's sort of pointing at that. But I thought Devin White played fine. I mean, yeah, no, he's not Ray Lewis yet, or he, you know, it's just he was fine. Like the defense gave up 7 points. Like I don't know, and he was third in the team in tackles, so I thought he was okay. What happened to Mike Edwards? Well, you know, I don't know. I think that he did. Only thing I really saw him, he had a pass breakup. It was late in the game on third down. I think it's when they had to come in and kick the field goal. So that was good. I think it was because he missed so much time during the preseason because he did. Like he got hurt like right after. He was hurt before the Steelers game, played the Steelers game, and then was hurt right after that, and like didn't even practice until after sorry, after the Dallas games. So, you know, they're putting Darian Stewart in there a lot, sort of to you know, ease him in there, but I thought Edwards was fine. You know, I wasn't really looking specifically for him, but I thought he was good. I didn't have any problem with Edwards. Do you agree this is the worst first half for us since? Sorry, it's hard to read these as it's scrolling. Since a year or two ago when the Bears tore us apart. No, because, you know, this is something I talked about. The defense are going to keep us in games. Like, hey, you know, by the way, it was a crappy first half. It was hard to watch. It was really clunky. We had the ball like the whole first quarter, didn't have the ball at all in the whole second quarter. It evened out to be sort of like 50-50 by halftime. But guess what? We were winning. We were winning 7-6 at halftime. So, I mean, as bad as it was, we were winning. And why? It's because the defense kept us in the game and actually, you know, scored the touchdown for us. So it's it wasn't fun to watch, but you know, that's just sort of that's what good teams do. Even when you're playing bad, you know, you go into halftime. I'm sure the Niners felt the way the Bucs played that they should have been up more by halftime. And how many times have you felt that as a Bucs fan? Man, we lost a lot of points down the field, and the game's over. And you look up, and you lost. And it's like all those times in the red zone, we didn't get in, we didn't get in. Well, this Buccaneers defense isn't gonna let a lot of people in the end zone. So, you know, I thought it was fine, you know, for game one and stuff. Devin White was basically invisible. Disagree, but whatever. Ren, would you rather see Mike Evans in active list than start? Would I rather see Mike Evans? Oh, I mean, for today? No, he had to play. It was just, I think the lack of targets for Evans and Godwin just really had to do sort of possibly with the game plan and just how clunky it was. Like every time it felt the Bucks got a little momentum, there'd be a penalty. You know, be a good run, and there'd be a penalty. We have a touchdown, there'd be a penalty. You know, it was a rough game to watch. You know, I found myself a lot more frustrated than I thought I would be for this game. Because every time I look at the score, I'm like, okay, well, we're winning, or okay, that's not so bad, or okay. But it just kept waiting for, you know, the offensive to sort of pick up a couple of first downs. And it felt like the only time they did that was in the first quarter when they ended up scoring two touchdowns that didn't count and then finally fumbled the ball away. And then sort of late in the fourth, like everything else was just, you know, pulling teeth to even just sort of get the quarterback center exchange. Suda and Faye played well. Thank you. Ren, this is a short week benefit or an issue for this team. I don't know. For me as a fan, it's a benefit because now I don't have to sort of stew on this until Sunday. You know, Carolina's having their problems. You know, basically Christian McCaffrey carried them. Late in the game to even get back in it. And their defense gave up a lot of rushing yards. So I wish it was at home so we didn't have to travel, but it's so early, everyone's still going to be fresh. And you know, with a game like this, it's kind of nice. I would think that it almost makes it like a throwaway. You know, you've heard that saying before where it's like, you know what, we're just going to burn the tape, not worry about it, and we're going to go on to Carolina. Because the things that were wrong were just dumb. It wasn't like the guys didn't know where they were. It wasn't like a communication breakdown. It was, you know, near the end, like late in the third and the fourth quarter, it's like all of a sudden the Bucs started missing tackles, you know, that we really needed that stop. And all of a sudden now we start missing tackles. And I really think the game is going to be played a lot cleaner as long as we don't have that same officiating crew, because those guys were really ticky-tacky, and they're ticky-tacky for both sides. I'm not saying it's the reason the Bucs lost at all, because they screwed the Niners just as bad they screwed us. They just wouldn't let them play football. You know, it got to the point, if someone threw a pass, it was incomplete, I was looking for a flag, and if someone, you know, ran the ball and it got some yardage or threw a pass and it was complete, I was looking for a flag, because it seemed to be, if it wasn't a run up the middle for like 3 to -2 yards, it seemed like there was a flag. So it was just, I thought it was poorly officiated all the way around. Let's see. So was it me or just the receivers not able to find separation? I'm with you. And I seemed that it felt like to me that it was sort of the play calling. Like I said, there wasn't a lot of slants, crosses. I think there was only like one screen pass to a running back. I know they tried it late with Dare. Obviously, that didn't work out. But that's how, it was just like, it was just so, I know I keep saying it, clunky, 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 but it just was. It was, they couldn't get into a rhythm at all. Like, they couldn't go two plays without a penalty. It just felt like that. And it was just like, ugh. It's like, can't we just get some, you know, couldn't move the chains and sort of wear the defense down. Now, it happened sort of late in the fourth when they started running Rojo. But then we got in the red zone and it sort of stalled. And, you know, when the field shrinks up like that, it's a lot harder to run the ball up the middle, you know, especially against, you know, that defensive front. Let's see. Both you guys clog up the middle. Pressure from Jimmy G. Do you think it will be 3 more for VH3 to get his next pick? No, I don't. VH3 is going to lead the team in picks with more than one. Carlton Davis is going to lead the team in pass breaks up. Will Golson is going to lead the team in batted down passes. Donovan Sue is going to lead the team in tackle for losses. And probably Shaq Barrett's going to lead the team in sacks because he's off to a 1-0 start. So we'll see. We'll see. Did Murphy Bunting get any burn today? I didn't see him. I didn't see Murphy Bunting in at all. And the refs' defense, it was their first game too. Yeah, okay. I mean, but it felt like they were micromanaging, you know, like they were set out there with, like, they knew what they're going to look for and they were going to call that. And that's what they're going to, I mean, they called all kinds of stuff. I mean, they called illegal formation, which means the tackle was set too far back in a pass set for the 49ers. I mean, come on now. It's like you never see that call. And then they call the intentional grounding on Jameis. Like, you never see that. Like, you know what he's doing. Like, okay, he's not out of the tackle box, but he really wasn't in danger of being sacked. I mean, it's like Bruce Arians said after the game presser, like, some quarterbacks are never going to get called on that. Like, never. ever. And we know who they are. They're never going to get called on that. And it was just, they were just too ticky-tacky. It was weird. Do you think it's crazy to be thinking about the QB in the first round next year early, like people overreacting are? Yes, it is crazy. And that's what sort of made me sad about how it was so set up for Jameis. You know, 2 minutes, 15 seconds, one timeout, 75 yards, score a touchdown, win the game. And just, it didn't even get a chance to get started. It was the first play, it was pick six. And it was like, you got to be kidding me. It's like, it was all set up for you. And yeah, it disappointed me. But then, of course, my brain went right to, oh, Jesus, Twitter. Like, oh, my God. Like, here we go. And I still haven't really been on a lot. I kind of stay off Twitter during, you know, Sundays and now Saturdays as well, because Florida State's not winning. So my whole entire Twitter feed is people crying about Florida State. So, yes, it's too early to worry about Jameis Winston in the draft. In your opinion, is Rojo the starter now? No. I still think it's going to be a 50-50 take. I wouldn't be surprised if they try to get Rojo started earlier next game. And he might start next game, but I don't think it's like Rojo's going to start and Peyton Barber is going to disappear, you know, right off into the sunset. I still think it's going to be a 1-2 punch, at least for the foreseeable future. What do you think it would take for BA to say screw it and take back the play calling? I don't know. I thought about that. I kind of, you know, with the offense only getting like one touchdown, I almost tweeted out like, you know, the BA play calling watch clock starts now. Like, you know, the clock starts now. But I'm sure we'll get to the bottom of that. You know, BA at the press conference said, oh, yeah, you know, Leftwich called a great game. But we'll see. You know, there was a couple of shots in the sideline where, you know, BA and Leftwich were right next to each other. And it felt like BA, it looked like sometimes BA was coaching Leftwich and, you know, like, hey, what are you going to call here? What are you going to call here? And I'm sure he stepped in sometimes. So, you know, I really don't want to get into, so I really don't care about it right now. I don't want to get that to be a story at all. And I really don't want to do it after one game. It's like, you know, well, who called the play in the fourth quarter, you know, on fourth and like that fourth down play, you know, where they had the field goal unit out and they pulled them off after the penalty. Like, who called that play? Was it Leftwich or was it BA? Who do we blame? You know, and you don't blame either of them. You blame Jameis because he threw the ball late. It doesn't matter who really called it, but I don't want to get it. I don't want it to get there now. I don't want it to get there now. Do you see a point in the season where OJ grabs a tight end one spot from Bray? Bray still looks better than me. OJ is tight end one. End of story. I'm not going to talk about if he looked better than Braid or not. It's just OJ's tight end one and will be until he's not a Buccaneer. I think Rojo deserves to start the next game. It doesn't matter because they're going to switch out. Like, if Rojo's out on the field, you know, play one for the offense, that doesn't mean he's going to get the ball more. It just doesn't. You know, BA said he's going to ride the hot hand. And, you know, obviously Rojo had the hot hand, so he got the carries late. Yep, the hot hand. Okay, I mean, when he became more of a, looks like Braid is still his favorite. Okay, unless he has. Did I skip your question? Sorry. Probably had to something. I'm sorry. Retype it. Going on 45. I'm going to call us at like 45 minutes. I'm going to have a lot of editing to do because I've got this of me just going, yeah, looking at the chat room. And once again, guys, this is only going to happen twice. It's tonight and it's going to be the Giants game. And I think for sure, after, you know, sort of struggling here, trying to interact with you guys, I'm gonna have a guest on and we'll be able to go, we'll be a back and forth with that person, and then of course take, you know, questions from the chat room. Real good running backs don't see the sidelines. Is it still too early to think about QB next round? Yes, talked about that. IE Bucks Nation's here. My field goal at kickoff, I don't know what time it was. Not a question, but the move Jameis had to make, Bosa looked silly and something wanted to gif. Okay, I don't want to do gif. OJ had a bad game. Yes, OJ did have a bad game. Why not call a QB sneak from the shotgun on fourth and goal? Jameis, the big boy. I was sort of wondering why they went with a pass, especially since they were running the ball well. I was hoping for my bunch big formation and then get Eau Claire to flare out and get one of those, you know, four touchdowns I thought he was going to get this year, because I think you're going to go big, and you got, you know, Evans and Howard and Godwin, or maybe Braid out there with Eau Claire to be in tight, be a blocker, and he's just going to squirt out and be totally uncovered. And I think it's going to happen like 3-4 times this year. I think Eau Claire is going to get like four touchdowns, and I was hoping that's what they were going to do. But, you know, it was you know, the Bucs did enough to win. The defense definitely did enough to win. It was just, you know, those two terrible throws by Jameis and the rest. And the rest got in the way for both teams. They just did. It was just – it was a clunky – it was just one of those things where when you watch the game, it's going to be shown, like, how not to ref an NFL game. And I'm not blaming the loss on the refs because, like I said, they screwed the 49ers just as bad. But – they made it not fun to watch. And I can understand if these penalties were egregious, but they weren't. They were like, when San Francisco had one of their touchdowns that was called back, I think it was the first one, and the guy ran around the end sort of untouched, like, I would have never called that hold on Whitehead. Did he have him? Yeah, he had him by his shoulder a little bit, but as soon as Whitehead turned, he let go, and the running back was already by him. You know, lucky for us, but I wouldn't have called that. Like I said, the first dot penalty, Jameis's intentional grounding, and that's loss of down. Like, we're in the red zone now, all of a sudden we're back, like, you know, back on the 19 yard line, it's second down. It's like you're just making the game not fun to watch. And like I said, they weren't egregious penalties. Carlton Davis's penalty, you know, when Jimmy G threw it deep and, you know, they just sort of bumped into each other as the guy was running by Carlton, and he was getting in trail position, and he just, you know, and Jimmy G missed him like by 10 yards, and it's like, that penalty. And it's like, well, yeah, it is, but you can't play aggressive cornerbacking with that officiating crew, because it was so ticky tacky. It was bad. All right, I'm going to wrap this up here. I'm going to get some of these last couple of questions. See, are you a little concerned with OJ's fumbles or just bad luck? I am concerned with OJ's fumbles. I don't think it's ever going to pop up as sort of an issue, but, you know, he does drop the ball more than I would like, and so does Chris Godwin. To be perfectly honest with you, you know, Barber fumbled the ball twice today. That wasn't good. Dare was stripped after he was down. But, you know, they were just it wasn't crisp on offense, you know, and it could have been a lot worse with those fumbles. I mean, a quarterback center exchange like that, you know, that happened. You know, Jameis got the ball knocked out one time in the pocket, like that happened. It just wasn't sharp. But it's sort of like not one thing you could point to. It's like the one thing, like, what, like, of all the bad things that can happen, they all happen one time. It wasn't like, okay, you know, it was like one fumble that we didn't get. It was like, you know, it was just weird. It was a weird, clunky game. I mean, we still should have won it, and I'm not happy about the way it went, but it was just, I'm kind of just stashing this as like, oh, well, like, you know, c'est la vie. It was just crappy. Do you think being down by 6 instead of 3 set Jameis up for trying too hard? No, but it would have been a lot better if he was down by 3. Like, and that was BA's fault. It was. What are the biggest things you're looking for the Carolina to come out with the win in a short week? Score more points than the Panthers. I think that'll probably do it for us. Rojo starting over Barber. No, they're both going to be 50-50. I would have loved to see an old school play where they give Sue the ball. Okay, fine. Fourth and goal play wasn't bad. Winston was late on the throw. That's why it was deflected. Agreed. The Bucs are going to Carolina as long as we keep the turnovers down. I think we can win any of these games. And again, it's because of the defense. Like, the defense is going to keep us in games this year. They just are. They just are. Like, you saw it today. Like, we had no business being in that game, let alone leading at halftime. None. And we were. Like, that's when the offense struggles, that's what you're going to get. They're even going to keep us in every single game. They're that good. I'm telling you. Todd Bowles' defense is going to be fun to watch. Oh, and when Brent said something about, I see the defense gave up and I'm seeing a lot of tendencies, I have no idea what he's talking about. Like, no, like that actually made me mad when I heard him say that. Like, I was mad. Like, reading a stupid, dumb Joe Bucs fan article, like, I can't believe they printed this. Like, that's how mad I was. So I'm sure we'll talk about it on a Tuesday night, and it'll be out Wednesday, because I just don't understand what his point was. Where those penalties for holding Sumajit seemed flimsy. Yes, agreed. Heard that as well. Fanner fans were way more loud, sad, and appalling. The one thought that brought it TVs back. Okay. All right, guys. That's it. Sorry the show was a little rough. I'm going to have to do some editing. It'll be out shortly. But thank you for all that joined. Our numbers have really gone up. Even from last year during the off season, they shot up by like 200, 300, 500, so we're averaging about 300 more people an episode than we were even during the season last year, during the off season. I'm looking at it now. There's we're around 50 people in the chat room. That's a lot. For us, that's about double normally what we get. So, some big things are probably going to come for us. We're in some negotiations with this and that. We've got some more things planned for you. Be ready for the guests on Tuesday, the quote unquote experts, the guys in the room. Be sure to get your emails out to thepewtercast@gmail.com. We're doing that show again, of course. We've already put one out. And then the Buck in the News one, you'll get that on Saturday morning to sort of, think about what we're thinking about the Carolina game, and it will be every week, and the injury report and all the stuff that's come out. So and we'll talk about all the press conferences and see what's going on. So, thank you, everybody, for joining me. Sorry it was a little rough. I'm a little hyped up on coffee, and for some reason I lost my voice like right in the middle of talking. So if you have any questions, you can always tweet me at Rendax, @RENDAXT. If you don't want to put it out on the Twitterverse, of course, you can slide into my DMs, and I'll talk Buccaneers football with you there, too. And, of course, Brent runs the Pewtercast Twitter feed. You can get in touch with him there as well. And that'll be it. Just to let you know, Lane Johnson, there's no W in my name. It's not Wen. It's Ren. But I get it. Sometimes it sounds like with a W, W-R-E-N. Anyway, everybody. Thanks for joining us. I'm going to put this out on the pod soon, and we will be back at you Wednesday. Well, we might even go earlier. Might have to go earlier because it's a short week. Anyway, you're getting, we're back to four pods a week. You'll be getting them. This will be here for you tomorrow morning. And Rendax signing off. Talk to you soon.
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.